Woodruff on the NewsHour tonight. On the border, thousands of unaccompanied minors overwhelm migrant holding facilities. Our team is on the ground speaking to families who have been denied entry and sent back to Mexico. Then, getting the vaccine. Another inoculation proves effective, but questions remain about distribution in the United States amid a rise of new COVID cases. And crackdown. Foreign journalists face threats and intimidation from the Chinese government for doing their job.
They seem to think that if we're not towing the government line 100%, then therefore we are the enemy.
All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by...
Before we talk about your investments, what's new?
Well, Audrey's expecting.
Twins.
Grandparents.
We want to put money aside for them, so change in plans.
All right, let's see what we can adjust. We'd be closer to the twins.
Change in plans.
Okay.
Mom, are you painting again? You could sell these.
Let me guess, change in plans?
At Fidelity, a change in plans is always part of the plan.
Consumer Cellular. Johnson & Johnson. BNSF Railway. The William and Flora Hewlett Foundation. For more than 50 years, advancing ideas and supporting institutions to promote a better world. At Hewlett.org. The Chan Zuckerberg Initiative. Working to build a more healthy, just, and inclusive future for everyone at CZI.org. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Dramatic new images from migrant facilities on the U.S.-Mexico border have emerged today. That comes as the Biden administration dispatches top officials to address the sharp increase in migrants seeking asylum. Amna Nawaz has been on both sides of the border today, and she reports from McAllen, Texas.
Amid an influx of immigrant children coming to the southern border, new images have surfaced from inside the overcrowded border facilities on the U.S. side. These photos provided to PBS NewsHour by Congressman Henry Cuellar of Texas show adults and children bunched together on sleeping mats at a makeshift tent facility in Donna, Texas, operated by U.S. Customs and Border Protection. It comes amid an outcry from a bipartisan group of U.S. senators after they toured a border facility last Friday with Homeland Security Secretary Alejandro Mayorkas. Press were barred from the trip. Democratic Senator Chris Murphy said that he fought back tears while touring the facility. Republican Senator Shelley Moore Capito of West Virginia said the facilities were, quote, overrun.
The numbers are just continuing to grow, and there's no impedance for these children to be coming in.
Mayorkas told ABC News yesterday the Biden administration is working to move children out of temporary border facilities as quickly as possible. He added one final message for immigrants hoping to journey north now.
Now is not the time to come. Do not come. The journey is dangerous. We are building safe, orderly, and humane ways to address the needs of vulnerable children.
The Biden administration today sent officials to Mexico to meet with Mexican officials about efforts to stem migration north.
And Amna joins me now from McAllen, Texas, on the U.S. southern border, where it is very windy this afternoon. So hello, Amna. Tell us, how much difference can those meetings with Mexican officials make?
Well, certainly, Judy, I think they're hoping that those meetings can help to stem some of the flow making its way up to the U.S. southern border. But the truth is that the problem starts much further south. I have to tell you, the vast majority of people we met with today are coming from those three Central American countries of El Salvador, Guatemala, and Honduras. And we should also mention, you know, the numbers of people crossing the U.S. southern border has been increasing since May of last year. That's something we don't talk about a lot. It did increase dramatically in the fall. And of course, here we are hitting these 20-year highs with over 100,000 people crossing in February. But it's important to note, too, the vast majority of people crossing the border, over 80%, are single adults. And the vast majority of people crossing that border are still being almost immediately expelled. That includes families. We, in fact, crossed over into Mexico today to a town called Reynosa, where many of these migrant families are now sort of sheltering after recently being expelled by the Biden administration. They said they crossed within a matter of hours in some cases. They were fingerprinted, photographed, and then walked right back across the bridge, the border crossing into Mexico. In some cases, they didn't know they were being sent back to Mexico until they were dropped off. We met with a lawyer who actually works with some of these families. Her name is Jennifer Harbury. She works with a group called Lawyers for Good Government. And here's what she told us about some of the migrant families we met sheltering in one particular park.
Almost all of these people are Central American families with children, including small children, who tried to cross and were sent back under the COVID rules. They were just dumped at the foot of the bridge. Mm-hmm. And now they've been forced to stay over here, close to the foot of the bridge.
And Amna, as you say, the vast majority of people are being sent back, but unaccompanied children are allowed to stay. How much is that taxing the system?
Oh, incredibly, Judy. I mean, we've been seeing this in the reports. We've been reporting this on this ourselves. Our system is not meant to handle this many unaccompanied children. Then those numbers have been increasing. We now know, according to a source familiar with the information who isn't allowed to speak to the media, we know that that backup, the fact that the shelters that house these children they're supposed to be transferred to, working under reduced capacity in the pandemic, there's a backup now in the Border Patrol facilities where children are not meant to be staying. We now know over 3,000 of the thousands of children in Border Patrol facilities have been held there longer than 72 hours. 72 hours is the legal limit they're supposed to be there. We also know over 800 have been held in those facilities for more than 10 days. Now, one of the things I should point out is with some of these migrant families we spoke to who've been recently expelled, they now feel they have to make a tough choice. Many of them were asking, should I send my child alone? Would he or she have a better chance of making their way into the United States, some of them as young as 8 or 9 or 10 years old, if I allowed them to go alone? We actually met one woman, a mother named Adarosa, who left Honduras, she says, fleeing unspeakable violence. Her 27-year-old son had been murdered in front of her. Her 14-year-old son had also witnessed the crime, but they said they don't trust the authorities to report it to them. So they made their way to the U.S., to the southern border, spent their life savings, have survived and seen unspeakable scenes, and they were immediately expelled back into Mexico. Here's what Adarosa told us about how she perceived she was treated by U.S. officials.
I was looking for protection, but they didn't help me. It didn't matter to them that my son was killed. They didn't care that he was killed. They turned me back. I don't have any money, and I haven't eaten.
So hard to hear that, Amna. We know the Biden administration has said over and over again, don't come, now is not the time to come. Is that message getting across at all?
Judy, from the families we spoke to, it is not. I asked a group of those migrant families we spoke to, have any of you heard President Biden say the border is closed? Not a single person raised his or her hand. So I asked him, what have you heard? Because many of them began their journeys 3, 4, in some cases 5 or 6 months ago. And they said, we heard when President Biden is in office, there will be no deportations. It will be easier for young children to enter. And quite frankly, the people who are in the business of moving people, that is the smugglers and the traffickers who are incentivized to move as many people as they can, they have been helping to amplify this message. Now is the time to come. So these families are spending thousands of dollars and risking their lives to make their journey. The message the Biden administration wants to deliver is not landing in these communities. Judy.
Such a tough situation. Amna Nawaz at the U.S. southern border in McAllen, Texas. And Amna will be reporting from there tomorrow. Amna, thank you.
Thanks, Judy.
I'm Vanessa Ruiz in for Stephanie Tsai. We'll return to Judy Woodruff and the full program after the latest headlines. In Boulder, Colorado this evening, there has been a shooting at a supermarket that has left multiple people dead. Law enforcement officials responded, bringing in SWAT teams, tactical vehicles, and surrounding the building. Police said there were multiple people killed, including one police officer. Police have taken one person, who is the only person with injuries, into custody. AstraZeneca announced a U.S. study shows its COVID vaccine is 79% effective overall. The company said it will soon seek federal approval for the vaccine. That news came as infections are accelerating again in several states. The head of the CDC, Dr. Rochelle Walensky, urged Americans today to take heed.
We must act now, and I am worried that if we don't take the right actions now, we will have another avoidable surge, just as we are seeing in Europe right now, and just as we are so aggressively scaling up vaccination.
Walensky also urged caution before traveling. More than 1.5 million people passed through U.S. airport checkpoints on Sunday, the most in a year. Meanwhile, in Miami Beach, Florida, this was the scene. Thousands of spring break revelers defied mask wearing and social distancing over the weekend. Officials have now authorized an overnight curfew through April 12. Representative Mo Brooks, a staunch supporter of President Trump, has announced his entry into the Alabama Senate race in 2022. Current Senator Richard Shelby announced he would not seek re-election. At an event at a gun range in Alabama this evening, Brooks appeared with former Trump advisor Stephen Miller. Brooks has been criticized for using heated language at the rally preceding the January 6 riot at the Capitol. The U.S. Supreme Court will consider reinstating the death sentence for Johar Tsarnaev, the convicted Boston Marathon bomber. A lower court threw out the sentence last July, citing possible jury bias. President Biden has pledged to end the federal death penalty, but has not asked the Justice Department to intervene in this case. And in Australia, the worst flooding in 60 years left thousands more people facing possible evacuations around Sydney. 3 days of rain have sent rivers pouring over large swaths of land and already forced some 18,000 people to flee. Others are scrambling to save their livestock and bracing for more downpours. The same region suffered catastrophic wildfires just 1 year ago. Saudi Arabia today proposed a ceasefire in Yemen between a Sunni coalition and Shiite rebels aligned with Iran. The plan also calls for reopening a major airport in Sana'a, the country's capital city. The Saudis are under U.S. pressure to end 6 years of conflict in Yemen. And back in this country, the U.S. Senate easily confirmed Boston Mayor Marty Walsh as Secretary of Labor. He will be the first head of the Labor Department in nearly 50 years to have been a union member. And Pro Basketball Hall of Famer Elgin Baylor died today in Los Angeles of natural causes. Starting in 1958, he played 14 seasons with the Lakers in Minneapolis and then Los Angeles. His high-scoring, acrobatic game made him an All-Star 11 times. Elgin Baylor was 86 years old. Still to come on the News Hour, another vaccine proves effective, but questions remain about its distribution in the U.S. Journalists face intimidation as the Chinese government moves to stifle reporting. The NCAA's unequal treatment of basketball players sparks outrage, plus much more.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
AstraZeneca announced today that their vaccine is not only safe, but extremely effective at preventing the most serious outcomes from COVID-19. In the largest COVID vaccine trial yet, AstraZeneca's was 79% effective in preventing symptomatic infections. The company will soon seek approval in the U.S. And as William Brangham tells us, the question now is where it fits into the overall distribution plan in the U.S. and internationally.
That's right, Judy. We haven't seen the raw data yet, just what the company has put out. But AstraZeneca's latest trial included 32,000 people, and it prevented both hospitalizations and deaths. And this is important because this vaccine is a crucial part of the international effort to distribute shots to less wealthy countries. Dr. Naheed Badalia is the medical director of the Special Pathogens Unit at Boston Medical Center and an associate professor of infectious diseases at Boston University School of Medicine. Dr. Badalia, great to have you back on the NewsHour. Do you share the judgment that this is another piece of very good news, that we now have a fourth vaccine that is proven quite effective against COVID-19?
I do, William. If the FDA's evaluation holds up the data that we're seeing today, it's good news because it adds a fourth candidate to the U.S. fight at a time that we're rushing to cover our population with immunity. But it's been called the vaccine for the world because, as you said, it's making up the lion's share of the vaccines distributed by COVAX, the WHO's utility, to try to get the vaccines out to most of the rest of the world. It happens to be about $2 to $3 per dose. It can be refrigerated and regular refrigerators for about 6 months. Ability to get out to the most sort of isolated parts of the world. And for all those reasons, and the fact that it serves as another data point showing efficacy and safety, this is a big plus for global health, and it's a big plus for U.S. health as well.
Indeed, we could use all the big pluses we can get right now. I know there had been some concern recently over some blood clot side effects. This caused several European nations a week or so ago to stop using this vaccine. European regulators looked at it, didn't seem to think that there was any real concern about side effects. Did this current trial from AstraZeneca address any or show any additional side effects for this vaccine?
Well, William, I think it's good to cover why there was this concern, right? I think what we saw from AstraZeneca and the UK authorities last Sunday was about a week ago was that the numbers of people who developed blood clots was the same among the 17 million people who've gotten this in the UK compared to those in the general population. The concern from the US, the EU authorities was that they were seeing these blood clots that are often found in younger patients that just are rare diseases that occur among the general population. And what the European Medicines Association has been able to show is that there really does not seem to be a causal link between the two. And what this trial does is, at least in this well-controlled setting, shows you that this is, you know, it's unlikely that this is a common side effect. And the fact that it does not occur, even in this controlled setting, at higher frequency among people who receive the vaccines compared to the placebo.
We know, of course, there are these so-called variants of concern from several different regions around the world. What is our understanding of how this vaccine does against those variants?
The most common variant that we're seeing here in the U.S. is the one that was originally discovered in U.K., the B.1.1.7. The good news in that front is that that particular variant seems to be maintained. You know, all the vaccines on the market, including the AstraZeneca, seem to maintain good activity against that. The ones we're concerned about is the one that was initially discovered in South Africa, the 1351, and the P1 from Brazil, both of which, you know, in the laboratory settings already show lower efficacy for Moderna, Pfizer, and for AstraZeneca in prior studies in South Africa, as well as in Latin America, have shown a drop in efficacy. The important thing is that their efficacy against severe disease, hospitalizations, and death still seems to hold out. So as the companies, both AstraZeneca and others, work on their boosters to address this variance, I think it's still going to be important to get this version of the vaccines out because it's going to help us protect the health systems and more severe disease.
Right, as you're saying, if it protects against hospitalizations and deaths, in the end, I mean, of course, we want to prevent infections, but stopping people from going to the hospital or dying is obviously enormously important. As we were saying before, the FDA has not approved this shot. No one in the U.S. is currently getting the AstraZeneca vaccine. They are going to apply for an emergency use authorization. Do you think that approval will come, and do you think we will start seeing this vaccine deployed here?
Yeah, I think that if the FDA finds that the data holds up, it is likely to get an emergency use authorization. The more important question is how commonly will it be used? So 30 million doses of this vaccine already sit here on U.S. ground. And we know that the Biden administration has said that by May 1st, even projections based on existing approved vaccines, there should be enough for all Americans. What the White House advisor, Andy Slavitt, today said that is they're not going to, because they're concerned that they want to make sure the manufacturing for the existing vaccines hold up, they're not going to make decisions yet about whether or not AstraZeneca is going to be needed or not. Likely, I think it may be deployed in those settings if manufacturing for other vaccines don't work out. One thing that I do hope happens is that those surplus doses that are sitting around, I hope we send it around to the rest of the globe, because transmission anywhere is going to be a threat to all of us getting back to normal.
All right, Dr. Naheed Badalia of the Boston University School of Medicine, thank you very much for being here.
Thank you, William.
An alarming new report accuses authorities in China of stepping up their efforts to harass and intimidate foreign journalists. Over the past year, Chinese officials claiming to guard public health have singled out journalists, denied them access to carry out their work, and in some cases, pressured them to leave the country. Special correspondent Patrick Falk reports from Beijing.
This is me getting cordoned in again. Actually, 2 minutes ago, I was told I wasn't allowed to stand on the pavement here, but now we're being ushered back onto it. There's going to be a little bit of a game of cat and mouse all day. We'll be moved from one spot to another because these guys really don't want us to be reporting on this story today.
Reporters in China getting the sort of treatment we've gotten used to. This was at the trial hearing for Michael Kovrig, the Canadian charged with espionage today in Beijing. Security here went to great lengths to frustrate coverage of the story. But according to the Foreign Correspondents Club of China's annual survey on media freedoms in the country, it's just the tip of the iceberg, and conditions for journalists in the past year have gotten much worse.
The restrictions that any foreign journalist faces inside China is extraordinarily onerous, and it makes it difficult at times to report freely.
The New York Times' Stephen Lee Myers is one of several American correspondents caught up in a clampdown on foreign media in the past year. Last March, he was thrown out of China altogether, along with the rest of the Times' American staff operating in the country, as ties flared between the Trump administration and Beijing over the coronavirus pandemic.
In the middle of a pandemic, we were given 10 days to pack up and leave.
The move came weeks after the Trump White House hit Chinese journalists working for five state-backed organizations deemed as propaganda outlets in the U.S., limiting the number of visas issued to them to 100. There were about 160 Chinese citizens working for those outlets at the time, which means around 60 were effectively expelled. American journalists working for the New York Times, Washington Post, and Wall Street Journal were all told to leave. China said it was a necessary response to the oppression its media organizations experienced in the U.S.
They couched it as being reciprocal, but obviously it was targeted at news organizations that they particularly didn't like. And whether or not it was proportionate, I mean, they would argue that it is. But the number of Chinese journalists allowed to operate in the United States even now is far greater than the number of Americans that are allowed to operate in China.
According to figures provided by the Foreign Correspondents Club of China, there are now just 39 American journalists working in the country. But the worsening conditions for reporters here go beyond the diplomatic feud between China and the U.S. and the expulsions. The Foreign Correspondents Club of China said in its report that all arms of state power were used to harass and intimidate journalists, and that new surveillance systems and strict controls on movement were implemented to limit them. We've all faced a challenging year as a result of the pandemic, but what's been frustrating for many of us journalists working here in China is that many of these systems and controls imposed by authorities didn't even apply to other people living here, whether they were Chinese or foreign. Notably, authorities created pressure for journalists and their news organizations by either refusing or delaying the process for the renewal of press cards required for them to work here. Some journalists surveyed in the report said they'd been forced to live and work in China on a series of short-term visas valid for between 1 and 3 months.
Which is very difficult because for journalists, they need to know that they've got some continuity in their job.
Keith Richberg is the director of the University of Hong Kong's Journalism and Media Studies Center and a former China correspondent for The Washington Post. He says there's a growing sense in Beijing that China doesn't need foreign media as much as it did in the past when it wanted to highlight to the world its rapid economic development. And he fears Hong Kong's become a more difficult place for journalists to work since national security legislation was rolled out in the territory last year.
They do seem to be going more in that direction of the mainland, where they seem to see us not as, you know, doing a legitimate job and questioning and being, you know, questioning in a critical way. But they seem to think that if we're not towing the government line 100%, then therefore we are the enemy.
The cutting of press credentials and refusal to renew visas resulted in the largest expulsion of foreign journalists from China since the aftermath of the Tiananmen Square massacre more than 3 decades ago. Many of the restrictions put in place in the last year have been done so in the name of public health and China's battle with the coronavirus. But several Western media reports say Beijing is retaliating against negative coverage of the outbreak in Wuhan and other sensitive topics.
I think in all the big crises that China go through, they want to show that they handle it pretty well. So, of course, every time we or foreign journalists, but also some Chinese journalists, of course, like try to show a different reality or a different truth, of course, they've been like kept from doing what they were doing.
Justine Jankowski is the China correspondent for French national broadcaster TF1.
I basically couldn't enter anywhere.
She says she's frequently encountered roadblocks while covering the pandemic and other stories. But one of the most alarming incidents that occurred over the last year was when Australian journalists Bill Birtles and Mike Smith were barred from leaving the country, allegedly for national security reasons. They were permitted to go only after a tense diplomatic standoff. Another Australian, Chung Lei, who was a news anchor for state broadcaster CGTN, was arrested in September and charged with supplying state secrets overseas.
So of course, you feel more at risk because you always believe that it's not going to happen to you because you're not the main target or for some reasons. And then you read that and you're like, okay, that can actually happen to anyone, depending on the diplomatic situation between the countries.
Foreign correspondents aren't the only ones in the firing line. Chinese staff working for international media faced substantial pressure over their work. Journalist for Bloomberg News Hayes Fan was detained in December. No details have been provided on where she is or what she's been detained for. People journalists sought to interview have faced threats and intimidation too, raising ethical concerns on reporting.
We're definitely not the one taking the bigger risk. The Chinese people are the one who talk to us.
The Correspondents Club noted the rapid decline in media freedom in China comes as it gears up to host the Beijing Winter Olympics in 2022. There have been calls in the U.S. and elsewhere for a boycott of the Games over human rights concerns, including the mass detention of Uyghur Muslims and Beijing's crackdown in Hong Kong. But Washington can play a part in reducing tensions that skyrocketed under the Trump administration so that pressure is taken off journalists.
The Beijing authorities want a reset in the relations with the United States. One good place for the Biden administration to start would be to kind of call off this kind of war that has seen journalists and reporters caught as crossfire.
It's hard to say if or when conditions will improve, but many agree that relations between China and the rest of the world won't get better without journalists building a better understanding of this complex and calculating global power. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Patrick Falk in Beijing.
Stimulus money from the latest COVID relief bill is arriving in bank accounts all over the country. Here's a look at how some people plan to spend that money and what they say about the president's legislation.
My name is Leandro Bell. I am a 59-year-old unemployed black male. I live in Baton Rouge, Louisiana.
My name is Jason Wellman. I'm the president of Feldershine Northeast out of Denver, Pennsylvania. We're a small business for restaurants. We do fire prevention related services.
I'm Nova Harper. I'm from Georgia. I live in Kingsland near the Florida line. I'm a custodian in an elementary school. I had to move once the pandemic hit the quarantine started, and I had a nervous breakdown. I was running out of money, and I'm currently living with family, sleeping on a couch, and working at an elementary school, making $900 and some change a month, trying to save up enough to get my own apartment. I have not received my stimulus check. I will be receiving one, but I have not gotten it yet. I'm going to put it in savings until I have more from my tax returns and other money that I put away from my paycheck until I can afford to move.
My name is Naila Hendrickson. I live in Arizona, and I'm a project specialist for a Fortune 500 manufacturing company. I was able to pay down a lot of my son's hospital bills from his self-harm and his attempted suicide during COVID. He is 16 and was out of school due to COVID, and he had actually three attempts committing suicide, and had to be hospitalized and put into a mental hospital. In those three attempts, we have over $10,000 worth of bills, and that's with insurance.
My name is Dr. Mimi Perot, and I'm a journalism professor in Tennessee at East Tennessee State University, and I live in Boone, North Carolina. I have four children. The oldest is 9 and the youngest is 2. So that actually made doing my job very challenging. I think financially, what's really helped me with the pandemic actually is the student loan payments being deferred, because we were really having to make some decisions about how much childcare we were able to use and pay on our student loans from graduate school.
My personal opinion of this entire relief bill is there's a lot of wasted money. Our biggest struggle right now and what we're trying to work through is employees, hiring new employees, if you will. There's just our labor force is very, very slim right now. They're now basically being incentivized not to look for employment, to stay home, you know, on top of their normal unemployment. They're also getting a federal unemployment of an additional $300 a week now until September. It's time to incentivize workers to get back to work. The only way that we're going to recover as a country is we got to get our employees back out there doing work and earning the money the right way. We can't incentivize them to stay home.
I was afraid to get out and look for employment because of COVID, not knowing, you know, because I have high blood pressure and high cholesterol, I'm at high risk. So I didn't want to risk my health to get a job. It's going to be a big help, but it's not enough. Home repairs. I'm also going to catch my bills up and probably buy myself a pair of shoes. So it could have been more, but I'm grateful that it is the amount that it is.
No question that a number of Americans are hurting right now. And as you hear, reactions to President Biden's COVID relief bill vary from family to family and from person to person. For a look now at the political implications of that relief bill, it's time for Politics Monday. And I'm joined by Amy Walter of the Cook Political Report and Aaron Haynes of the 19th News. Hello to both of you. It's so good to see you. Amy, it's tough to listen to some of these stories, and we know there are different views of this COVID relief plan and what it's going to mean for American families and for individuals. But the question I have right now is in terms of President Biden and what he's able to do going forward, how much can he translate any support he's getting for this into where he goes from here?
Yeah, it's a really important question, Judy, because right now things are looking pretty good for President Biden. You know, he's only been in the job for, what is it now, 6-7 weeks. His job approval rating is in the mid-50s, certainly a lot better than, say, where President Trump was at this point in his first term. Approval of the stimulus package, the American Rescue Plan, is somewhere in the 60s. President Biden's approval rating on handling the pandemic, also in the 60s. But we're in the first inning here, and we've got a long way to go, both in terms of the economy, the pandemic, and also the political realities for the president and for his party. And sometimes, Judy, you know, the first inning tells us a lot about how the game is going to go. A lot of times it tells us absolutely nothing. And so I think what I was really struck by some of these stories, for example, the number of of people who are saying that they're going to put this money into savings, pay down student loans. You know, obviously, this was intended to be stimulative, right? This money goes right back out into the economy. There's a theory, there's this pent-up demand. People are going to start spending. The economy is going to come back. They're going to start hiring. They took a big, you know, bet, the Democratic, this administration and Democrats who voted for it, that indeed putting this much money into the economy was going to supercharge it. It may. We only heard a handful of voices, and experts believe that it will. But again, we're still really early on in this process.
No question, Aaron. But it is something we want to know. We want to understand how is the reception to all this going to matter as the administration moves ahead with other things it's trying to do, whether related to the economy, related to immigration, climate, and so on.
Yeah, Judy, and I think that that's why you're seeing, you know, as soon as President Biden signed that legislation, he and Vice President Harris, and frankly, it was all hands on deck, the first lady, the second gentleman, everybody hitting the road to explain to Americans exactly what was in that pandemic relief package, even as those stimulus checks were starting to hit their accounts, because I think that that money was something that Americans understood, you know, right away. We heard from some of them just now talking about the things that they are able to do with some of that money, whether it is, you know, paying you know, hospital bills or you know, being able to stay afloat with food or shelter here in a way that they weren't able to do, frankly, before they got that check. But there are other things that are in that pandemic relief package that they that this administration is wanting to make sure that people are aware of, you know, particularly the things that disproportionately could benefit women and other marginalized communities. I mean, I'm thinking about, you know, first of all, the $14 billion for an equitable vaccine rollout, as the president is touting the 100 million shots, you know, in the first in under the first 100 days, I mean, well ahead of schedule on that. Although, you know, in terms of whether or not that's been happening equitably, that is still at issue. But this pandemic relief package is aimed at trying to make that more equitable. But I mean, you know, money for school reopening, money for childcare. You know, you heard from Mimi, who was talking about how she has struggled to stay in the workforce. We know how many millions of women have dropped out of the workforce because childcare was an issue. And so I think, yeah, looking ahead, certainly as this infrastructure plan is taking shape, thinking about how that is really going to help Americans on a more permanent basis get to a new normal on the other side of this pandemic, that this pandemic relief package, you know, I think is maybe an early indication of the direction that the administration plans to go in and what they are trying to show that they can deliver for voters, frankly, whether they voted for this administration or not.
And Amy, of course, one of the other big headaches right now for the administration as they try to talk up what they've just done with COVID relief is what's happening at the southern border. As we saw with Amna's reporting earlier in the program, there is a real problem the administration's dealing with there, a large number of unaccompanied children trying to figure out what to do with them. Republicans are blaming this administration. They're saying this is the Biden border crisis. The administration is saying, wait a minute, this all started under President Trump. How much does it matter who's labeled or who's tagged with being responsible for this, Amy?
Right. Well, unfortunately, we know that the issue of immigration has been used as a cudgel, as a wedge, for years in political fights. And it's part of the reason I would argue that there hasn't been sort of a push to solve it, because it's a really easy, quick tool to use in a political fight. At the same time, we also know that the Biden administration, they campaigned on reversing so much of what Donald Trump did on immigration and did that immediately right out of the gate, but also sent pretty mixed signals, Judy, about what they wanted, what they were telling the rest of the world and potential migrants, which is, we don't want you to come, but if you do, if you're a minor especially, you can stay. And so that sort of mixed message is making it really challenging. And we also know, Judy, that the Democratic Party itself, we saw this during the Democratic primary, is pretty divided about what to do on the issue of immigration. Joe Biden spent a lot of time during the primaries getting attacked from his left for things that the Obama administration did that many on the left thought were punitive to people who came here illegally. And at the same time, we know that there are many on the left who not only want to do things differently than what Donald Trump did, but wanted to go even further, including things like, you know, getting rid of penalties for crossing the border illegally, which Joe Biden pushed back on. So that divide is also really important between the, you know, within the party, between more activist and progressive forces and the reality on the ground and what is actually happening and how challenging it is, even when you're trying to roll back something that you say is inhumane, how challenging it is to make it actually work.
Right. And Aaron, watching all this very closely, because however this is turning out in the early days of the administration is going to affect the administration's ability to get anything done with regard to long-term immigration reform.
You're right, Judy. And listen, I mean, there were a lot of voters in that coalition that elected President Biden and Vice President Harris who wanted to see big systemic change around the issue of immigration. And, you know, obviously, you think back to the 2018 midterms and you had former President Trump really raising the specter of these migrant caravan hordes, you know, headed for the border as an issue to try to rile up, to galvanize his base. Then you can be sure that as the midterms come back into focus next year, you could see immigration, you know, with maybe the pandemic a little bit more in the rear view, immigration coming back into focus. People had, you know, very strong reactions on both sides to the family separations issue, to what they saw happening at the border, you know, a couple of summers ago. And so immigration is still very much an issue that people want to see addressed. I mean, they're not so focused on blame as they are, you know, wanting to get some answers. And you know, so the Biden administration, frankly, doesn't get to really have it both ways. Just as they inherited the pandemic and they're responding to that, they've also inherited this immigration crisis, and people are also expecting a response there, too.
Nothing quiet about these early days for the Biden administration. Thank you both, Aaron Haynes, Amy Walter, and we should say Tamara Keith away tonight. We especially appreciate Aaron being with us. Good to have you both. Thank you.
You're welcome, Judy.
Thanks, Judy.
The NCAA basketball tournament is now well underway, but even before the opening tip-off, new anger and frustration erupted over the differences in how the NCAA approaches the men's and the women's teams. John Yang has a closer look.
I got something to show y'all.
On TikTok, the inequities between the men's and women's tournaments laid bare.
This is our weight room. Let me show y'all the men's weight room.
It began Thursday when the University of Oregon's Sedona Prince posted a video from a tournament site in San Antonio. University of South Carolina head coach Don Staley, a member of the Basketball Hall of Fame, slammed the NCAA.
Either it's miscommunication, no communication, or just not downright caring if people know what's happening on our side of things. And that must stop.
The NCAA initially blamed limited space in San Antonio. Later, Dan Gavitt, the NCAA's top basketball executive, acknowledged that wasn't the case.
When we don't meet the expectations of that support, that's on me, and for that I apologize. To the women's basketball student athletes, to the coaches, to the women's basketball committee, for dropping the ball.
We got a weight room, yeah!
By Saturday, a new weight room. But the uproar highlighted other differences between the men's and women's tournament, including less reliable COVID testing and less online promotion for the women.
Today, the Wall Street Journal reported that the NCAA has withheld the iconic brand March Madness from the women's tournament, reserving it exclusively for the men's championship. Sally Jenkins is an award-winning sports writer for The Washington Post, the first woman inducted into the National Sports Writers and Sportscasters Hall of Fame. Sally, thanks so much for joining us. So the NCAA was fast to address the weight room issue. I've read they're also doing something about the meals at the women's tournament. But that really is small potatoes compared to some of the issues you wrote about in your column over the weekend, including money.
Well, and primarily promotion. You know, this is a potential flagship event for the NCAA. And yet, if you look at a lot of the games, the floor, you can't even tell that they're playing a championship. You know, literally, there's not a lot of decaling on the floor to tell you that you're watching a championship event. You might think you were watching a high school tournament. You might think you were watching a, you know, a junior college tournament. The difference in presentation is really striking at times. So that's one thing that's been bothering some of the coaches I've talked to. And then, of course, there's just a pervasive sort of lesser than. It's everything from meals to, you know, really petty details that don't mean very much, but they are a sign of a lack of respect that the women feel.
Some people would argue, well, the men's tournament brings in so much more money than the women's tournament. But the popularity of the women's tournament has been gaining. ESPN, which knows how to make money, has been expanding its coverage. And if they did have that marketing support, do you think that disparity would in the money, in the revenue, would get smaller?
The women's tournament only looks small in comparison to the gargantuan, you know, $1 billion in revenue that the men's tournament brings in. But by any other standard, it's a very, very large, very successful event. I'll give you an example. I mean, just in the last 2 years, they've acquired the number of advertisers on the women's tournament has leaped from 70 to 87. They've brought in 17 more large title sponsors, large corporate sponsors. Everybody from Verizon to AT&T is pouring a lot more money into the women's tournament. You know, it's a growth event. But the other thing that they command is 4 million viewers when it comes to the championship game. Again, that may look small compared to 10 million for a men's Final Four game in viewership, but 4 million is not small. It's only small compared to this massive other event. It's bigger than a Wimbledon final. It's about on a par with a National League pennant series. There's lots of very, very large American sports events that it's in the same ballpark with. And so the idea that it somehow constantly has to be diminished in the eyes of the NCAA is really it's silly, number one. And number two, it's really counterproductive in terms of building the event.
And it's not just that the men's, the schools that win the men's championship get a bigger share of the revenue than the schools that win the women's championship. The schools that win the women's championship get no share of the revenue. Is that right?
They get zip, zero, not one cent. Now, there's going to be all kinds of revenue generated by the women's tournament. And for some reason, all of the revenue seems to be factored onto the men's side. The women get counted as cost and burden as opposed to revenue production. You know, it doesn't add up. The math here is a little funny for one thing. I mean, this is clearly a revenue producing event. And yet we're told that the women are simply an inconvenient cost item for the NCAA.
What's it going to take to change this?
Well, it would help if Congress would tell the NCAA to crack open the books. You know, it would be nice to see someone like Katie Porter do one of her numbers with a board and a magic marker, because the math, again, is not adding up. There's huge audience. There's huge sponsorship numbers. There's huge ad dollars. The women deserve to know what kind of revenue they are generating and what kind of revenue their programs are entitled to.
Sally Jenkins of the Washington Post, thank you very much.
My pleasure.
We continue now our look at the alchemy of health and art with Jeffrey Brown's profile of a physician poet, or perhaps a poet physician. It's all part of our arts and culture series, Canvas.
I haven't seen you in a while.
I know.
Morning rounds at Baylor St. Luke's Medical Center in Houston.
Good morning, Yetta.
Where Dr. Fadi Judah practices internal medicine.
Night? How was the pain?
And you're breathing better?
I'm breathing better.
Well, I got good news, which is your kidneys are doing much better.
In a time of pandemic, the hospital itself is eerily quiet. Doctors and nurses likely to be the only people a patient sees.
Good morning.
It's a little cruel. There's almost a panic if you fall ill these days because you feel like you're being sent into solitary confinement, whether from COVID or not. And that really is painful to carry around as a physician and internalize.
Judah was born in nearby Austin, but spent most of his youth in the Middle East, in Libya and Saudi Arabia, the child of Palestinian refugees. The impulse to healing, he says, stems from a sense of displacement.
As a young boy, I remember feeling I needed to become a doctor because the world or my immediate family needed compassion and support. I remember this moment very well, actually. In the kitchen, we were living at the time in Benghazi, Libya. I broke out and said, "Don't worry, when I'm older, I'll be a doctor and I'll have a big house. We'll all live there together. And if anyone falls ill, I'll take care of you."
Later, he would work in emergency rooms and on missions for Doctors Without Borders. And always, alongside medicine, another passion, poetry.
The storm funneled through town with destructive intent. Fractured tree limbs, toppled fences, ripped shingles like tufts of hair.
His first collection was chosen in 2008 for the prestigious Yale Series of Younger Poets by Louise Gluck, the 2020 Nobel Prize winner. A later volume, Text 2, features short poems the length of texts. His most recent book reaches for the heavens, with allusions to astronomy and even astrological signs, while remaining grounded in the everyday. It's titled Tethered to Stars.
Some of the themes, whether they are about my relationship to being a physician or being a Palestinian American or bilingual or whatnot, they maybe free themselves into time a little bit more, a little bit away from this notion that everything we speak in America has to be, so to speak, on the census form.
Here, even disasters play out in everyday human terms. The poem House of Mercury describes the aftermath of a recent hurricane that blew through a part of Houston where Judah's parents live. Subtly, in the background, the pandemic.
On the second day, I cut up the rest of the branches, deepened the earth for the fig, enjoyed a long, lazy lunch with my parents, and on the way home, heard a radio report on whether the sky is bluer during a pandemic. This was earlier last year. The highways are empty and the city seemed affected by the pandemic lockdown. It just struck me that in the end, we cannot escape how beautiful we want to feel life is.
We're gonna do takeout.
Judah and his wife, Hannah El Sali, have two children, and the pandemic changed life at home in another way. Hannah is an infectious disease doctor and researcher who served as a lead investigator for the Moderna vaccine.
Literally, the whole world is watching and waiting.
Yes, that part is the stressful part, right? Like sometimes it felt like, you know, if we can be just left alone so we can do what we need to do and then we'll figure out how we sort of present it. So that was actually part of the challenge, being constantly in a fishbowl, if you will.
I asked Hannah which hat she sees her husband most at home in now.
Oh, okay.
Doctor or poet?
That answer is easy. He is definitely more in his elements when he's reading and writing. He appears more content, more on a mission kind of thing when he's reading and writing.
Both partners in this two-doctor household say both science and art, medicine and poetry, require an imaginative mind that sees beyond research data or life's routine moments. And for Fatty Judah, there's an added benefit to loving and caring about language.
Being a poet and a writer and hopefully a better listener, I've learned to use a language of faith or hope or support or terseness sometimes to communicate with my patients better.
House of Mercury ends with a lunch at his parents' house.
Hummus, falafel, shakshuka, followed by tea and stories about fear that comes to nothing. The kids said it was the best falafel they'd ever had. And Mom said that going forward, her morning glories will get the light they deserve.
A lesson in what even fallen trees can bring. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jeffrey Brown.
Such a great report. Thank you, Jeffrey. And on the PBS NewsHour online, for years, lawmakers have debated how to fight poverty. We explore how the pandemic is changing America's approach, including small success stories across the country. That's on our website, pbs.org/newshour. And that is the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Judy Woodruff. Join us online and again here tomorrow evening. For all of us at the PBS NewsHour, thank you. Please stay safe, and we'll see you soon.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by Consumer Cellular, Johnson & Johnson, BNSF Railway, The Candida Fund, committed to advancing restorative justice and meaningful work through investments in transformative leaders and ideas. More at CandidaFund.org.
The Alfred P. Sloan Foundation, driven by the promise of great ideas.
Supported by the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, committed to building a more just, verdant, and peaceful world. More information at macfound.org. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you. This is PBS NewsHour West, from WETA studios in Washington and from our bureau at the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
You're watching PBS.